Oh, Jesus, Brian. What's up with all these people around here?
Wait, you're talking about... you're still talking... Where are you going, Justin?
Well, you know, I mean, I'm just trying to say, hey, what's up?
Well, this is weird. We're in a warehouse of some variety. And yeah, now you're pointing at meats.
Jesus and Jesus and meats. That's what I'm talking about, fucker.
I think you're... What the fuck? That's fucked up, bro. You brought a goat in the mix.
Jesus meats. Jesus meats. Jesus meats. You're the sheets.
Okay, look. I've got a beard. I'm homeless. I'm working for you.
I don't care about you. Jesus meats. Jesus meats. Right. Jesus meats and meats and Jesus.
I swear to God, if you show that fucking goat one more time...
Oh, the goat is what you want? Well, maybe I'll bring him back.
God damn it. Fuck you. Start the show. Oh, hello, you beautiful people. It's Tuesday night. And that means it has got to be go time for the best of the worst of the internet. Night Attack. Hello, I'm Brian Brushwood in Austin, Texas, joined, as always, by my BFF and OAK, JRY. What's up, Justin Robert Young?
Oh, my God, dude. It is yet another week of Night Attack, and I think that we have another all-timer here on our hands. I'm just really excited. I'm in a good mood, man. Taxes are paid, which is good, and I'm ready to get into the rest of the year.
Hey. So, did you have that happy moment, sad moment? The old sad moment forcibly punched into the chest of a happy moment. Wait, no, the reverse. The happy moment punched into the chest of a sad moment and then left on your doorstep. So, you rang the doorbell and you look, yeah. You're like, oh, it's a sad moment. And sad moment looks in your eyes and says, hello, Justin. I'm the harsh reality of your tax bill. And you pick him up. You're like, oh, another mouth to feed. And then it says, but look inside me. And he reaches into his chest and rips it apart, exposing, along with the blood and effluvia, you see a glowing orb. And you're like, is that an infinity stone? And it says, no, that's your happy moment. And you pull out, you reach into the baby's chest and you pull out this glowing orb. You wipe, you try to wipe the blood off, but eventually you just suck it off because you know that'll get it cleaner faster. And you look at it and the glowing happy moment is... Oh, I made enough money to pay it this year.
Okay, so wait, but you have to talk. But has to be in the voice because the sad moment has a voice. So that's got to have a voice.
Well, that was me, you reading the sad moment, but that's fine. You're like, I'm the happy. You're like, sad moment says, have you seen the happy moment? It's in your fingers. Perhaps you would just lick off the blood and you can read the text upon it, sir.
Very fixated on this blood licking, but go ahead.
I hear that if you lick the blood off that happy moment, it will speak to you and tell you your happy truth.
I'm sure r/bloodlickers is going to be thrilled by this bit.
Justin, are you going to actually lick off the blood or not?
Sorry. Yeah.
Hello, I'm your happy moment. You may be sad that you had such a big tax bill this year, but don't worry, you have enough money to pay it, I assume. Otherwise, Brian Brushwood will be very sad he constructed this whole bit just to reveal you're deeply in debt to the IRS.
Yeah.
Also, would you please place me back inside the sad moment? That's where I'm happiest.
Yeah, sure, happy moment. Here you go.
Okay, just squeeze me. Oh, my, that really hurts. Please stop. Oh, God. Oh, please, you didn't place me in quite the right way, sir. Will you please make sure... Oh, you're punching us. That's not right. That's...
So, how was your morning?
Good, you know, but yeah, no, the taxes stuff are done. And indeed I had that feeling. It was one of those things where it's like, oh, I guess I got to go check my bank accounts. And the answer was just kind of moving money from one account to the other, as opposed to like, shit. I can't fucking die again, me. Oh, geez. You really worked it up this time. So, yeah, that was good.
Well, what happened next? So you're there freaking out. And I assume Ashley walked in and says, hey, Whiskers, will you get off the stream? What are you doing?
I know. Yeah, no, she was yelling. I'm like, nothing's wrong. Why do you think something's wrong, you bitch? why is it? Why is it always me? Why can't this Goo be wrong?
This is an awfully weird way for my husband to be acting. I need to get on the tube and take a lift to Twitch heaven. But before I do, I'm going to eat some vegan fries, and you best explain yourself.
And then I just jumped out the window.
Oh, let me make sure he didn't land on any animals. Okay, we're good.
Yeah, man, no, it was definitely it's just good to get away from it, right? Just paying all that goddamn money.
Yeah, no, there was two shocking moments. One was when the phone call came and it's like, you owe this much, followed by me being the bigger surprise was me saying, okay. Like, that was pretty great. Turns
Seems
out that
a fair trade.
So quick recommendation to all you kiddos out there. Be constantly paranoid, terrified, ashamed of whatever success comes to you, and keep everything in one account labeled give to IRS. And as long as you do that, you'll be able to handle tax day.
The main bank account. Like, literally the operational bank account of your business, just label immediately drain for IRS.
Hey, man, I feel like we got to talk about the elephant in the room.
Yeah, so I've gotten this a lot. I'm sure you have probably gotten it even more because you are in Austin, and that is the man, just like it is so Texas for everybody just to be gossiping about somebody's custody trial, right? And like, it's just like, oh, did you hear about Alex?
Okay,
Katie, they're going to court now.
Okay, but here's the thing: of all the places I expected to hear about it, I did not expect it to be from when I walked into the room, and Bonnie, and of course I'm this is the biggest week of that I've had in months. A lot of stuff going on, and so I come in wild-eyed after a full day of doing this class, and Bonnie, you know, is just like, "Hi, how are you doing?" And I'm like, "I'm great, I'm getting ready for Cord Killers." And then Bonnie doesn't approve of that. By the way, your not approval, Bonnie, just means I've solidified my Bonnie impression. She says, "How you doing?"
Oh, I sound like the ad dragon.
Yeah, yeah, I was gonna say, yeah, it's very ad dragon.
The ad dragon had a stroke.
Hey man, I didn't judge you for looking at fisting comics.
That's not how that situation went in the pre-show, and I would recommend everyone be a patron at patreon.com to hear the real truth from fake news.
Fake news. That's your new ripcord for everything. So Bonnie goes. Bonnie puts her hands on her head. She's like, "Well, I'm just really worried about this court case." And then I'm just like, "What, the Alex Jones one where he's disputing custody of his kids with his ex-wife?" And she goes, and then Bonnie, here's the best part, is Bonnie doesn't say, "Yeah, that bears an eerily similar resemblance to us." Instead, she just, you know, does the picture infomercial where they're doing the black and white thing, and she can't get something to work, so she just
there's
throws her hands up.
Be a better way.
Yeah. She goes. Yeah. Isn't that exactly our situation? And I'm like, well, number one, Bonnie, we're not getting divorced.
Okay. All right. Well, here, hold on. Let's set it up for people that have not heard about this story. Alex Jones got divorced from his wife, I believe, in 2015. He has primary custody of their three kids. Now she, the ex-wife, is going to custody court to see whether she can get sole or joint custody of their three children that they have together. Part of her argument is that Alex Jones is unfit to be their primary caregiver because he's fucking Alex Jones, and they've just played clips.
Hold on, time out real quick. I would like to flash forward to the courtroom scene where it's just like, Your Honor, if you look at Exhibit A, and it's just a photo of Alex Jones, and they're like, the prosecution rests. Like, that appears to be their whole thing, right?
Well, no, basically, like, they played in the breakdown in the Austin American Statesman, they went through the defendant's or the ex-wife's, like, point. And so the first clip was a very fatherly clip of Alex Jones, like, inviting his kids on camera and just being, like, a nice dad, designed to anchor that the kids are involved in everything. And then it just devolves into every, like, you know, like, hacking goblins, just catch them in bed with a goblin. Like, you know, like, Alec Baldwin, I will punch you in the face. I will break your neck, you son of a... Oh, I'm sorry. I know we have a lot of Christians affiliates, but Jesus Christ!
Okay. So, real quick, press pause on that, because there's plenty to parse there. Dial it back to, many people are wondering why you and me, are the nexus. We're the CNN of CNN coverage of this. Like everybody's just well, I could watch the lamestream drive-by media, or I could go to his neighbor, Brian Brushwood, who has met him three or four times over the last 20 years and almost certainly shares the same zip code and definitely ran into him at the local liquor store and again at Blazer Tag, wherein we saw him playing Fruit Ninja with his children, and you and I exchanged pleasantries with him. And we might have been planning for almost 4 years now about how we would like to create the definitive Star Wars interview featuring Alex Jones.
We have reached out to Alex Jones multiple times to set up an interview where he only talks about Star Wars. It's something that has been a holy grail for us for maybe as long as Brian and I have known each other. It's just always been one of those ideas. But this was the big key. In Alex Jones's own defense, his lawyer said that you cannot, as the jury, judge Alex Jones on, I think the judge is actually just deciding it. You cannot judge him on what you see in those clips, because Alex Jones is a performance artist, and to judge him, real quote, by what you see in those clips is like judging the character of Jack Nicholson by his portrayal of the Joker in Batman. That's the metaphor his lawyer used. And it's like, have you seen a fucking movie in 30 years?
Okay. All right. Now time out, because I do want to revisit the repercussions of what this means, because Alex Jones, his brand is authenticity, right? Mm-hmm. His brand is true believer. But let's dial it back and just talk about, before we dive into that, his specific, let's talk about Bonnie's concern when I walk in and she puts her hands on it. She pulls up her Daisy Dukes and says, "Oh, Brian."
No, if you're gonna, I like this. I like you making me a lot sexier than I am.
She was in the middle of flirting with some cops who were just leaving, and they didn't notice.
She was just casually washing her car. Sudsy thing.
Eating a giant hamburger.
That's right. Oh, yes, exactly. Hold on. Time out on all of that. Have you seen the new ad campaign?
Have you seen Jessica Simpson lately? No.
Oh Jesus. Wow. Very different interests.
No. I need the 105.9 the cat bumper. Like, just whenever Price gets catty like that.
No, for the first time I watched Better Call Saul on Sling TV, which meant I have to watch actual AMC ads, and they have this brand new ad campaign that basically is an abject apology for 10 years of horseshit. Have you seen this? I want to get your hot take on this. Just hit play on I don't know, anything.
That...
YouTube Hardee's Carl Jr. ad and whatever's new and hot. I'm sure it'll be in there, because
this is the inception of First Acts. We are just going. Like, I swear, I hope we remember the pathway back to the surface.
We're gonna get back there. There's no way we're gonna lose the thread.
Just remember, there it is. And Daisy Dukes.
Yeah, Bonnie's sexy and Daisy Dukes, and here she is.
You still talk to Stacy?
Yeah, finally replied to my DM.
Where are you, babe?
We're over here next to the barn.
I'm about to pet this cat right here.
Let me pet that cat.
Where's the cat?
Shoot the tiger. Go for Junior.
Junior, I think your dad is here.
What? Daddy, you're back. Yes.
Take that down. Put that up.
That was supposed to be a fresh ingredient. And then that lady got in there and her clothes flew off. It was windy.
Miss, would you please dismount that bull? Who's this?
This guy? I don't know him.
Shut up, Junior.
Yes, sir.
Hello, friend. You know, when I started this company, it was about one thing. Pioneering a new way to food.
So basically, they got Kurt Russell's older Kurt Russell to come in and just say, this past 10 years has been a fucking embarrassment, and we're taking it all back. We're making up a dad of our bullshit corporate identity, well, and our dad is ashamed
Carl
of us.
Carl's Jr. is the brand, and so he's Carl Sr. He's right. Carl Hardy Sr.
But that's just it. Is Carl's Jr. and Hardy's were always two separate brands. Hardy's bought Carl's Jr., and so some of them were called, and then they tried to fuse the identities. So I was like, none of this. There was never a Carl's Jr. There was never a Hardy's.
Well, I mean, this isn't a documentary.
Fuck yeah. No, that's right. We're pulling back the circle of the documentary. Documentary circle, that's a thing.
So anyway, so Bonnie said.
Yeah. All right, so Bonnie. Anyway, dude, I'm so fascinated with moves of corporate identity. Anyway, so Bonnie was just like, hey, this whole Alex Jones thing directly affects us because I don't know if you know this, Brian. And by the way, she puts on librarian glasses and she has a lab coat on and she's, you know, dealing with stem cells. What? And she says,
says, you are, by the way, your world building this episode is next level. You are on point.
And she said, listen, I don't know if you realize this, but you play a bit of a buffoon on the internet. And here I am looking at another outworldly character, and it seems like many of his actions have come back to bite him in the ass, so as it were. And so I want to know, are you doing the responsible thing as a parent and being a respectable citizen of the internet? And then my dad came in and said, Brian Jr., what are you doing in here?
So wait, is Bonnie still there?
No, she walked out.
We had a wild Callie showed up. She's taking care of it, so she'll be back in just a sec, but go ahead.
Okay, all right. I mean, but I'm sure that your explainer was like, no, this is because they're in a custody battle,
well,
right?
And she knows that, but here's what I suppose her
Oh, are you thinking
actual...
this is like a threat? Like, I've got footage of you on the internet, treat me right.
Okay, that never occurred to me,
oh, shit.
But you certainly escalated a new thread here. Which we will confront when she comes back in.
And Bonnie will be wearing a gilded ball gown.
Oh, look who just emerged. Resplendent in white slippers. Bonnie Brushwood, how are you?
I'm just fine, thank you.
Okay, so what when you expressed concern about this, can you put in your words before I try to interpret them.
Oh, okay.
like, what was it about this case that made you think, well, this is relevant to my interests?
Just the interpreting what you do on the internet. Because essentially he's doing the same kind of thing, like
so
podcasting.
All right, Ian McShane in the background.
Oh my God, I don't even know what that is. I'm looking at Brian being totally distracted, and I'm like, what's going on? No, okay. For audio listeners, just tune into the video feed. You'll see now. Okay. So, anyways, because the persona that you do on the internet could affect your personal life.
So if I could rephrase that as the way I took it, what I heard and thought is that Bonnie is saying,
stop all your dreams, Brian. The dreams come to a halt.
She said, stop your dreams and be a bigger man. And that's why I bought Super Vitality Pills 9000 XML.
Your dreams are turning the freaking frog gay.
What does that even mean?
Cross markup language?
So, no.
All right, so Bonnie, the big thing is that, like, the reason why this is in the news is because he's at a custody hearing. So really, you should be keeping all of this to yourself.
Time out. I think what she's worried about is, let's say, she's not worried about who gets the kids or how their situation was resolved. What she's worried about is the precedent that it sets.
Right.
Because if this is a successful attack on his character, if the defense is, no, what I do on the internet is not who I am as a father, and the jury or the judge comes back and says, no, it is, Bonnie, who has to deal with a neighborhood of people who are fairly intimately familiar with the shenanigans of one Brian Brushwood, all of a sudden has a bit of trouble.
Yeah. You know, when there was a hobo marching around the...
Okay, yes. There was definitely a time... Okay. There was definitely a time the cops almost got called because one of our neighbors looked out and there was an insane, raving, lunatic hobo marching his way right in, and it was only by the good grace of coincidence that they happened to notice the camera pointed at me as I was dressed as an insane person.
Right. And then they called me and said, that's your husband, right?
They didn't call the cops. We have to field all the 911s.
Basically.
They're like, my daughter's choking. This isn't one of your japes, is it?
And you have two buttons. The one says forward to 911. The other is, it's just a prank channel, bro.
But meanwhile, the phone sits atop a gilded ottoman that is bejeweled by the king's riches.
Goodness.
Dude, all right, so Bonnie, is this something that you're really worried about?
No, I do worry. You know, I'm not very articulate, so it's hard for me to speak about things. But I do watch these things because the court, you know, we're supposed to have checks and balances in the government. So,
are you inviting Trump?
Just
say fake news. Just shout fake news and pull that ripcord. You got this.
Fake news. Anyways, no. And in that is the way the courts decide on these cases. And so, if they set a precedent here, it just opens the gates for future lawsuits and things. So, yeah, I do think this could be pointed at in the future, and I'm curious what they do, especially since it's such a sensational character that they're looking at.
Now, mere moments ago, or maybe about an hour ago, the judge did rule that his rants were irrelevant to the entire case. So,
I hadn't gotten that word.
Yeah, we just found that. Breaking news.
But you realize,
does that make you feel better, Bon?
Yes, it does. Because I think that's true. Like, I think that our audience gets to know you guys, but I also feel like you're exaggerated forms of yourself. Like, you know.
Oh, without a doubt. Without a doubt.
Well, yeah.
Okay. So let's take the moment. Okay. Now that that's resolved, you are no longer worried that the government will steal our children because I talk about butts on the internet.
Yeah.
Now let's talk about the more fascinating enigma.
True. Yeah.
Because I think. The whole point of this attack on the on Alex Jones, the whole attack on the prosecution, is really like the damage is already done, because I think they introduced it specifically knowing it would be shut down. But for example, and Justin can speak to this, if the WWE is real, if Jerry Springer is real, then you are watching actual crimes be committed live on television.
Ooh.
You're watching assault and attempted murder on the regular.
Right.
That limo blew up.
Last week on Monday Night Raw, a man beat somebody so bad they had to go into an ambulance were strapped in. That man then flipped the ambulance with his bare hands, attempting to murder somebody else by moving an ambulance physically with his body.
Quick question. Was that collapsed ring a real thing or a setup gag? It had to be a setup gag, right?
Oh, yeah. No, they've done that like they do it like once every like 7 years or so.
Okay,
but
that's a pretty good one. That's a good gag.
Collapsed ring?
Yeah.
What's that?
By the way, you actually knew that it was going to happen because lately they put all these LCD things around the ring and on the ring post, and they just randomly weren't there at the beginning of the show. And so everyone's like, man, that's weird that they invested in all this set dressing and then just kind of forgot it. And then all of a sudden it's like, oh, these gigantic people are going to wrestle later. Okay, that makes sense.
That's funny. So in that regard, so the big I feel bad even attempting to tell this story because you could correct me as much as you want, Justin. But sure, I understood it, like in the late 90s, as internet culture started to make it easier to tell the truth to other people, wrestling had always operated under this tell everyone it's real, whatever. But then there came this conflict where enough people knew it was scripted that that people asked the question, well, if it's not scripted, this is assault, this is attempted murder, these are crimes. Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. There was a moment where Vince McMahon, the head of the then WWF, actually just had a monologue to camera where he explained that these were actors portraying people and that the storytelling was going to get more intense because we believe that the old good guy versus bad guy is passé. So, yeah, that was a moment where he said, this is going to get complex. There's going to be people that draw guns on each other, but they are not real. They are characters.
Right.
But here's an interesting thing that I heard is, Alex Jones
has a... The junkyard dog.
Yeah, no.
Oh, sorry.
Wait. Alex Jones has a press pass. So is he real news or is he fake news?
Well, and now you get into the most interesting question.
Right.
For us to discuss about my neighbor... Alex Jones, who I meet at the liquor store from time to time, mm-hmm. and watches him and his children play Fruit Ninja. That sounded creepier than I thought.
Yeah, you sound really creepy like you're doing this. Okay, you know.
Look, we went up and said hello. It was delightful.
He was very nice.
Yeah, he was chill, too.
So here's the question. Is his brand has one core identity, which is everything you hear from everyone else is a fake play-acting nightmare. It's not real. It's either part of the Illuminati at worst or part of a government cabal at best, part of a corrupt politician at the brightest. But the one person you can trust is me. And what happens when there's government documents that undercut all that? And so here's my question to you, Bonnie. Do you think this was ever a legitimate prosecution move to get the kids, or do you think the real move is I'm going to make you admit that you're not really committing crimes on the air? I'm going to make you admit that this is all fake. Which of those do you think it is? Do you think it was a I'm going to ruin your thing, or that I really think you're irresponsible with the kids?
No, I think that she wanted the kids back, or she wants to renegotiate whatever settlement they have in terms of what she gets, like in alimony or whatever. So, I think she was gunning for the kids, and she brought that up, and that was the easiest way that you could refute it, is just to say that it was immaterial. Mm-hmm. 2 seconds. You guys film for 2 seconds.
Okay, so...
Yeah, this is a woman who doesn't have custody of her kids. That's a concern for
her. So you say you do whatever you think your most powerful move is.
Yes.
And if a side effect of that move, if the move works, great, you got the kids. If the move doesn't work, great, his credibility has an earthquake thrown at it. Either way, you've got nothing to lose.
Right. Also, how do you lose... If you're a woman in Texas, how do you lose custody of your kids?
That's the other thing that I pointed out on jury today is like, let's also look at that.
Yeah.
They just got divorced and he has sole custody.
Yeah. I mean, although he's the one with the money and everything.
Sorry, say again, Justin.
I said that in America does not happen very often. Well, the idea that a guy does not, that the husband gets full custody of the kids. Like,
I mean,
joint,
certainly,
maybe,
certainly at
very
some point,
often sole for the wife, the mother.
Mm-hmm. I mean, certainly at some point, money will take you a certain distance. But at some point, this sounds dangerously close to me blaming. Yeah, I'm
yeah.
very gossipy. I don't feel comfortable. With it.
All right, so let's get to what people want to talk about. Is Alex Jones a fake, Brian? Yes or no?
Only insofar as I'm a fake, which means. Like, I mean, I live my life in polite society, and there are brief moments that I embrace flights of whimsy that for me often involve jokes about buttholes and whatever and hand jobs.
You lost the bet.
Oh, sorry. That was the bet, was I. Is this who I am with the children? No. Is this who I am in polite society? No. So I ask you this, sir, which one is the real me?
Kilroy.
Kilroy. Kilroy. So, and by which I can totally imagine a scenario in which Alex Jones, spends most of his day in polite society doing fulfilling his social obligations to his friends, his family, to people who he loves, to his fans, in doing the work that we all do. But during his broadcast, opens up his inner poet. And in that time, you disable filters and you ask questions. And you don't have time to reintroduce people all the way up. Like when he went on going about goblins making the frogs gay or whatever. Like, yeah. That was building on a long mythology that he took his fans in a long-term journey of if this, then this, and the other thing, and the other thing. He was speaking to people who had joined him on all of Journey Quest up until that point. And then, so out of context, yes, it does look like the rantings of a raving lunatic, but I would very much believe that you could grab either of our stuff out of context and make us look, if not as silly, just as silly about less politically charged topics.
So, yes.
Yes. Wait, what was the question?
Yes, he's a fake.
That he's fake.
As fake as a poet is a poet fake?
Is the wind fake? Is the color fake?
No, by which, and I'm serious about this.
Take a look upon the eyes of the wise owl. Would you deem that fake as well, pale face?
Is the glape fake?
Is the glape fake?
Fake dudes, fake dudes.
Okay, so define fake. By fake, do you mean that he absolutely disbelieves everything he says? Or real?
All right, so here. So give me yes or no. Does Alex Jones, at his core, believe that there is a globalist cabal and that Sandy Hook was a false flag and that there is traces of fetus in Pepsi sweetener?
Oh, my God.
I think that...
Yes or no? Yes or no?
I can't answer that in yes or no because it doesn't fit any yes or no. I think that you are watching on an Alex Jones broadcast essentially a strange version of D&D, in which he sets himself up with pieces of evidence and explores them to what might be logical conclusions if you accept them at face value. And as a theatrical conceit, he energizes his realizations with full-bodied apoplexia at times. And I think it is true insofar as he is accepting as starting theses the story that he is reading. And he is tying it in with other theses. Well, this thing, if we're gonna assume it's true, links in with this other thing that we've previously exposed if it's true. And if so, then the only logical conclusion could be that these three things and this other fourth thing could come together, in which case I would be real mad. I'd be so mad. I'd be bugged out by my male pills. And in that regard, I think it is a authentic exploration of his D&D scenario. But I think when it comes to where his investments are made, I think he has maybe a little less invested in gold than he would lead you to believe. I think he might have a little less of his actual money invested in meals ready to eat and bomb shelters than he might lead you to believe.
So, yes?
I mean, you tell me. How would you classify that as yes, fake, or no fake? Because I think when he's talking, it's all filters disabled.
Here's what I would say. Does he believe those things have a possibility of being true enough that somebody should explore them? Yes. I think that there is a conspiratorial element to his mind that is something that a lot of people obviously have responded to and that he has found a following for, that like indulging these ideas that everything could be connected and there has to be something on top of what we are seeing, and that there needs to be that somebody should ask these questions. Now, does he absolutely believe that they are all true in his heart of hearts? Probably not. Like,
well,
I think
you nailed it, because I think
the artifice there is, you know, that's where things can get artistic.
I think whether or not it's fake, if you want to distill it to a binary, either he's real or he's fake. I think in his mind, in that moment, in that frothing mouth insanity, I think it is real, because I think he's constructed a brief reality to express his opinions in. And in that regard, you're speaking to the true inner rage child of his soul. But then when later he's taking care of his children and managing his finances, my guess is you get a different version of him. So I'm going to say that he is real in that moment and that he's not real in other moments.
By the way, for everybody who's like, oh, he's a bad guy, we're not debating that. We're not debating whether or not he's good or bad for the world. We're just debating the duality of realness and fakeness.
Yes.
Because this was something that obviously touched a lot of people, because we both got bombarded with it. Like, that people wanted us to react to this thing. And by the way, Corey Coleman did a thing about it. Corey Coleman probably knows him of our circle of friends.
Even better. Dude, in fact, I know Corey Coleman specifically because of one of Alex Jones' girlfriends early on, before he got married. I was...
Well, it's not taking me to court, goddammit!
By the way, a number of people have mentioned it in the chat room.
The Elephant in the Room.
The Elephant in the Room is a fantastic read. If you want... And I think this is why I'm having a hard time buying into the binary, he's real, he's fake, it's good, it's bad, or any of that stuff, is if you read The Elephant in the Room, what you'll see is one human being finding good things in another human being, and some unbelievable circumstances and adventures, and the way two people interpret them. It's written by John Ronson, who's fantastic, and it's about him going on a caper with Alex Jones back in the day, and him meeting him again now in the wake of his newfound spotlight under the Trump administration.
So there we go. That's the Alex Jones conversation. Any final thoughts, Bonnie? What do you think about old?
Are you still worried?
I got the news. I think that's good.
You only worried about whether or not what I do on the internet is admissible in court.
Okay, when you put it like that, yes. But the other thing is, you can't do anything really illegal. But what I'm saying is just like persona, you know, judging people's character by show.
You know what? We haven't had this conversation. How would you describe my persona on the internet? Maybe there's a reason that you are more worried about this than I was.
What's different between internet Brian and real Brian?
I don't know. I would like to say he talks about wieners less, but I don't know. Anyways, at least not around the kids. But let me see. What was I going to say? Oh, I did think it was interesting that Rush Limbaugh might be losing a show.
Wait, what?
Yeah, I read that too. So, like, they're...
Well, I'll tell you what, Bonnie, if they're looking for a replacement, then boy, do I have the guy for them.
I know.
YOLO 420.
Bill O'Reilly.
Wait. Bill O'Reilly. I said the wrong guy.
Not Rush Limbaugh.
I'm so dumb. I'm really sorry.
Another lady host. The Drive By Media does this all the time. It's Bill O'Reilly who called a young lady who worked at Fox News who was black hot chocolate, losing his show. Bill O'Reilly. We'll be right back on the AIP network.
I didn't know that.
Oh my gosh, I'm sorry, guys.
All right. So that was Hey, shit stain, how about that loofah this time, huh? Fuck you, Bill O'Reilly. I'm going to dance on Bill O'Reilly's grave coming up next on the EIB network.
That was really good.
So think that Bill O'Reilly has written so many books about dead presidents because now he can write one about his dead career. Shitting in O'Reilly's mouth on the EIB network.
Oh my gosh. By the way, Brian's dad like feeds those to Penny. He'll read anything.
Oh yeah,
like,
he's okay. All of them. Okay.
Anyway,
we don't need to discuss the fact that my dad gives children's books written by Rush Limbaugh to our child. That's not a thing.
The grandparents might lose their visitation rights. Is Dad
could just explain. Not a reason, Bonnie, for your fine patriot in-laws to lose their visitation rights. I'm a great author of children's books like Eeny, Meeny, Miny, Moe. Bill O'Reilly's fired. Fuck you. On the
99.5 WRNO.
In which case, we'll just explain that my dad plays a character in my impression of the stories I tell him.
Well, I'll tell you what. Here's something else that. Well, Brian, if Brian, you know, if there was one place in all the world where people could support the Night Attack program, where would they do that, Brian?
Ah, well, that would be by buying Gold Bond medicated powder and lots of Ovaltine. And my new book, Preparedness, The Odyssey, a 16-volume extravaganza about what you can do when your blood pressure gets too high.
Also, patreon.com/nightattack.
Oh, yeah, I suppose you could go to patreon.com/nightattack, where you can join the nearly 1,500 patrons who keep us loud, live, and independent. Hot damn, would we love to get back to 1776 on our weekly contribution.
I mean, come on. In honor of Alex Jones.
Yeah, 1776. Pierce will rise again. And I'll tell you what, if you pledge a dollar, raise your pledge to a dollar, or raise your pledge over a dollar, you, my friends, get to participate in
the
ladies and gentlemen, it's time for the Night Attack new Patreon name chant corner hour.
Thanks so much for the buck, fucko.
Justin, I'm going to do something I've never done before. I don't know if you know this, but I don't have a lot of confidence in our skills as entertainers or comedians or social entrepreneurs or observational analysts.
All 12 of us know that.
Scientists, spies, computer engineers, video game writers, talk mm-hmm. show hosts, mm-hmm. magicians, mm-hmm. political correspondents.
What's that last guy do?
Ran Go Games. I don't believe in us.
Nope.
And as a result, I'm always suspicious of when the big raises come in. But tonight, I got to tell you, man, I felt the spirit move me. I felt like, hot damn, this is funny, insightful, witty. I begrudgingly might think that after 8 years of doing this, we might have something. And that's why I did not take this Patreon pledge as a jaded attempt in the last 4 minutes to cash in and get his name spoken. But instead, I think the spirit moved this person. I think this person was suddenly like, oh, my God. Oh, my God. My dad, Poodle Puncher Sr., just walked into the room and was very ashamed of me. So now I'm kicked out, and he's raised my Patreon. So let's hear it for Poodle Puncher.
Poodle Puncher.
Poodle Puncher.
Bonnie, hold on real quick. Bonnie, give me your best Rush Limbaugh impression.
Rush Limbaugh.
Yeah.
I'm gonna put him in a blender.
Okay, go.
And I'm gonna poor old puncher.
That was actually better than I thought. It
was a really good job of Scooby-Doo's impression of Alex Jones.
Turns out when you combine those three, you get Scooby-Doo.
You get Scooby-Doo a little bit. It's good. It's good.
Zoinks! It's the poodle puncher! Get out of here, Scoop! The sound of coconuts clapping.
Where are you? The globalists are out to find you.
The poodle puncher sounds just like Alex Jones screaming.
So poodle puncher, thank you so much for kicking in. Of course, if you want to get your name read on the name chant corner hour that may or may not devolve into us doing Alex Jones versions of Scooby-Doo,
just saying, now's a really good time.
Night Attack.
It's a good time to join us.
It wasn't even close to an hour.
Hey, buddy, we got a game tonight?
We do. And actually, you know, it's something that Bryce and I were talking about a little bit earlier today. And I'm not going to lie to you. I'm not very comfortable with it, with the game.
Oh, you don't like it?
I think he just thought it was maybe a little flippant.
Well, I mean, listen, Bonnie, you know, your point stands firm that you know, this is something that is recorded that I mean, like, I personally am going to have on the record forever. So, I mean, I know that we all have our different limits, but I'm not super comfortable with it. But we can start it and we'll just see how far I get.
I mean, look, I don't want to push you. Look, we ride the line on this show, and sometimes we've fought and we've had shows melt down. I don't want to jeopardize our friendship. I don't want to certainly jeopardize the custody of my children by doing anything that makes anybody uncomfortable here.
I've got a contingency plan, but let's go ahead and see what the game is.
Sure. Okay.
Well, we've played. I think we've. I don't know if this is a bit we've played on this game before or this is somewhere else. But you know, real or fake, right? I'm going to give you guys...
Real or fake, yeah. That's a game we played a lot, right? Just to decide whether something is real or fake.
Yeah.
Well, I mean, that's certainly a theme. I don't know that we've ever called it.
I don't know it's necessarily been the game.
Okay,
real or fake.
New game, we're going to call it... New game, familiar trope, we're going to call it Real or Fake!
So welcome to Real or Fake, the 20th of April edition.
And I'm going to be high as a kite by then.
Oh my gosh, I just realized that we're recording this just less than 28 hours from 420, National Weed Holiday.
That's right. And
oh, wow. I didn't realize that. I didn't. I'm not aware of what that is.
I mean, it's this thing that the weedsters do. That's what they call themselves, the weedsters.
You want to know what? I'm feeling a little anxious about it. Bryce, just explain what the game is.
Okay, so
understand, this is all on the record, and you don't have kids yet, Justin, that you know of.
But you're going to be associated with weed for the rest of your life.
So what are we going to do? You want to know? Guys, explain the rules. We'll figure something out. I hate to throw a monkey wrench into this.
Okay, all right. Well, I went through the internet. There's a website called leafly.com, which sounds like one of our startup spelling bee companies, but it might have been.
Yeah,
actually.
It does. What's its valuation? How many employees does it have?
$420,000. And so I went and found a bunch of wacky names for strains of weed. And so I'm going to give you the name and just a sentence or two about it. It's a crowdsourced website, so people have given kind of their reactions to
A minute. So this is like an Urban Dictionary or a Wikipedia for strains of weed that anybody can. Alex Berth says, fuck, God Bud is down.
Wait a second. Did Justin say, I need a game that I can win?
Buddy, are you going to say that Justin does weed?
I mean, first of all,
about
I mean, he's the one who tried to pull the plug on this whole thing. He said he was not comfortable with it, but that's fine. I'm sure it'll be just fine. Okay. All right, Bryce.
So I'm going to give maybe Bonnie, you can play it while
if I could guess, I assume the game is you're going to give us a strain of weed, and it's either a real strain of weed, according to weedster.org.
Leafly.com.
Okay, whatever. Or it's a made-up one that you invented.
Or it's going to be fake, right.
Yeah,
right.
Okay, all right.
So, for example, if I said Crouching Tiger, Hidden Alien, flavors of pine and spice come through on the inhale while ushering in full-body tranquility, would you say that's real or fake?
Man, I don't know. I mean, it's not me. I'm just paranoid. I'm all in my head right now. I can feel my heart beating.
Mm. Oh, yeah.
There it is. It's getting louder. I'm just all really.
We're on top of it. The ship's running.
Say it again.
Crouching Tiger, Hidden Alien.
There's a hidden alien around. I don't understand. I can't even hear over that heartbeat. Yes, it's real. It's real.
Say it's real. Bonnie, what do you think?
Sure. They're all going to be real, I'm sure.
If they're not real yet, they will be.
They will be after this.
Well, you're right. Crouching Tiger, Hidden Alien is a real weed.
By the way, for the record, Bryce. For the record, Bryce, you get as loud as you want of that heartbeat at any time.
Like that. I'm looking at Skype.
Are there any Goosebumps fans in the house?
Hold on. Wait a second. You're not Justin Robert Young. You're famed children's author RL Stine.
You're goddamn right I am. I'm RL Stine. I live alone. I enjoy my hot tub with a fine glass of port and a poorly rolled blunt. Look at this piece of shit. Oh my God.
It's got a stick sticking out of it. It's
a pasta thing. I'm so high right now. I'm RL Stine. I live alone. I used to write Goosebumps. In fact, I still do.
I think you still do. Well, yeah.
I mean, have you published many recently?
Everybody does. Hold on, the Stine Master needs to chief this bee. Smoke weed every day.
Well, RL, did you hear the rules about the game?
I write the rules.
Okay, great. Well, that's
all right. Well, I guess we're gonna play the game. I thought I could take down Justin.
Damn right we are. I'm RL Stine. I live alone. You're lucky I'm on this game. This reminds me of an argument I once got into with a supple Amy Tan.
Amy Tan, the author of the Joy Luck Club.
Oh, I got joyed and lucked that night.
RL Stine.
Well, when you live alone, it's easy to set up those sorts of social
boundaries. I live alone, I'm RL Stine.
Okay, well, I guess we're just going to have that.
All the strains.
All right, Bryce, take it away,
all
sir.
All right, well, here's our next weed. It's called Wizard of Odd, an otherworldly strain that fuses lemon and lime in an energetic healing potion that'll carry you down any yellow brick road.
I remember a manuscript I first wrote for Wizard of Odd.
Okay, that's not the name of the strain, but that's fine.
Oh. It was the name of an unpublished Goosebumps novel.
Okay. Wait, you're saying you wrote a book called The Wizard of Oz?
The Wizard of Odd. There was a man named Ted Odd and these three young middle school students, Jamie, and Joseph, figure them out.
And what happened?
That was pretty much it. It got rejected by Scholastic.
Maybe it was a little half-baked.
Was there any controversial bits that really set them off?
Well, there was the one time that Ted Odd decided to open his butt cheeks wide and dump his entire bowels onto an open Wall Street Journal. There wasn't really any plot development. I was kind of going through a phase.
Okay, but okay. It seems like if it didn't add to the story, you would have been okay with cutting it. When they asked you about that scene, how did you respond?
What?
it's a pretty natural response, I think.
I'm RL Stine. I live alone.
Okay, well, I'm sorry. Famed children author RL Stine.
I wrote the Goosebumps books. You're lucky you got. This is what I go into my hot tub in, by the way.
Okay, blazer. So, your very nice tan blazer.
So. So
So do you think it's real or fake?
Oh, that one's real.
Okay. Brian, the Wizard of Oz.
I want to believe it's real. It's got to be real.
All right, gentlemen. The Wizard of Oz is fake.
Oh! I knew it, that son of a bitch.
Are you blaming for Scholastic for your loss?
Oh, I'm blaming the run in this fat B-lunt for that loss. Wizard of Oz. That's how I would describe me rolling these blunts.
Okay. All right. So, take it away.
You have a very intimidating stare, RL.
That's what I do to get my jokes across. I'm sorry if my social cues are not what they used to be. I live alone.
Sorry, that was very ableist of me. All right, here's the next one. It's called Poochie Love.
I remember Poochie Love.
Wait, oh, did you used to smoke Poochie Love?
Well, to answer that, you have to first understand... One sweaty night in Houston, Texas, 1971, I was at a book fair where every library in the country would get whatever was offered. So next thing you know, I pitch something on the spot to the muckety-mucks at Scholastic. I say, it's Poochie Love. Somebody fucks a dog.
Alright, now normally your audience is young children. Normally you're pretty good at like dressing up the ghoulish behavior.
Like, Poochie Love is a very school friendly name.
I'm so glad you said that, because that was exactly what they said. I said, fine, dicks, a ghost fucks a dog. Can we just write this check? The cush is too loud.
Okay, so what about the weed strain? Do you believe that Poochie Love is a real strain of weed?
I don't have a lighter. God damn it. Across the wire. I live alone. Yeah. All right, is it real or is it fake?
Well, Brian,
I guess it would be on me. You know what? I should go first, RL. I think Poochie Love is real. It's just so ridiculous that it's got to be real.
RL?
I think this is real as well. Real!
All right, guys. You both got it right. Poochie Love is real.
RL, I feel like we're birds of a feather in that.
Birds of a feather. That's another one that got rejected.
Now, hold on. What was Birds of a Feather about? That's a fairly innocuous statement, I would imagine.
Yeah.
Birds of a Feather was a thrilling, yet erotic tome.
Was this part of Goosebumps,
or was it for adults?
Or was it Goosehumps? God.
So listen, these shit dicks at Scholastic, after the Money Factory Stine walks in their doors, they should be all creaming their jeans.
Yeah. RL Stine, you're so filthy.
I'm just saying, Stiney gotta eat, and I do.
Sure.
Food that gets delivered to my house, where I live alone.
And is that what inspired, Birds of the Feather? I would like some poultry tonight.
Birds of a Feather was a book that went as this verbatim. What are those things outside of my house? Oh, after some brief Googling, they're birds. The end. They rejected it.
Almost Shel Silverstein ass.
I mean, I'd hate to say you were phoning it in, RL Stine.
Oh, my God. Don't get me started on Shel Silverstein.
You know what? I want to hear about Shel Silverstein, but first let's tackle our next challenge. All right.
Our next strain is called Dog Shit. Dog Shit is a sativa-dominant hybrid strain named for its aroma, which bears a striking resemblance to its namesake. RL, you're spinning that weed with just the masterful technique.
This is what I do to intimidate my enemies.
You don't consider me your enemy, do you, RL? I'm your biggest fan.
This is a friendly game.
Not yet.
Well, I mean, we're tied. I could overtake you at any moment.
How about this? Dog shit! Real.
Okay.
Yeah, I'd hate to say it. That's such an awful name that I feel like there's no way Bryce would make that up to try to fool us. He would sooner say the Avengers 7 Fuck You Butthole Man as a title.
Avengers 7 Fuck You Butthole Man, and it's very heady.
It's cloudy.
That reminds me of the exact title I initially wanted to call the entire Goosebumps franchise.
Wow, that's such a long title.
That is number one. Goosebumps was number three. Number two, oops, these kids just shit their pants. It would come with a gimmick that would pay off in the third act.
That's pretty good because each book would end with a ghost popping out and the kids shitting their pants.
Oh, maybe... no, I shit my pants. Or if it was a period piece, I shit my pantaloons.
I thought you were going to say,
I had my period. I got my period.
My period in my pants.
Don't get gross.
Whoa. That's all a bit right. Misogynist of you, RL. I mean, it seems like...
Take away the shame. Sorry. From periods.
Sorry, this weed is talking to me, and it's saying, toodaloot.
All right. Well.
Toodaloot.
I'm RL Stine. I live alone. I drink port, and I smoke blunts that I've rolled poorly. This looks like if a piece of shit was left out on the street, and then it got homeless.
All right. It does look, all right. Dog shit's real. Dog shit's real. Smoke weed
every day. Yeah. Real quick, what's your beef with Shel Silverstein?
Yeah.
This fucker.
Oh, my gosh.
So all of a sudden, I'm driving down the 405. It's 1981, and Reagan fever is here, baby.
Catch it.
So next thing you know, I roll down my window. What do I see but the old tree fucker, Shel Silverstein, next to me.
Did he fuck trees?
Oh, sure. And then he wrote a big novel about it. Once there was a boy who fucked a tree, and he came inside the tree, and then the tree got pregnant. Bleep, blop, bloop, Shell. How about you walk your own ass off the end of the world where the sidewalk ends?
what was it about him personally that really set you off?
You know what? This fucking asshole, I forget. I'm high.
Okay, all right. Well, we'll get back to it. Do you have another one?
Yeah, here we go. How about devil fruit? Sweet and spicy in flavor and delivers a light cerebral stimulation followed by comfortable full body effects.
Is this me?
This is you, Bri.
All right, now this super fake because it sounds so real.
Okay. RL.
What was it again?
Shel Silverstein.
Is devil fruit.
Oh, that fucker. That's why I have a story about him. I was riding down the 405, and next thing you know, Reagan fever was here, baby.
Catch it.
I'm sorry. I didn't mean to derail you, RL. The question is whether or not...
Devil fruit.
Devil fruit is a real weed.
The giving tree's my dick.
So you're
very
generous?
I never got to say that to him.
You wanted to say
so
that,
I
guy.
Guess, you know, points on the scoreboard. RL1, Shell. What was it again? What was it?
Devil fruit. Sweet and spicy.
The devil fruit.
Sweet and spicy in flavor delivers a light cerebral stimulation followed by comfortable
devil
football
fruit.
Effects.
It's going to move ya. hi, and then says, ooh, yeah. He lives alone. He's drinking port and smoking blunts that are rolled poorly.
Are you the devil fruit?
Again?
Devil devil fruit. Are you? Did you just confess to being a satanic piece of...
Devil fruit.
Devil fruit.
Yeah, is Satan worshiping homosexual? The devil fruit. Devil fruits. I love two things.
What are the two things?
RL Stine answering questions and moving the thing along.
Devil fruit. I'm RL Stine, and I believe it's true.
Do you mean real?
Real.
All right, RL Stine, you got it right.
What?
RL knows.
That's right.
I mean, come on, I'm RL Stine. I've been writing books for over 4 decades. Do you think I ain't cheaped on some of that sweet ganj?
I'm just a little bit really upset. I mean, I didn't want to make a big deal about this about the beginning, but I mean, I had planned to donate the entirety of the $10,000 prize from this contest to, you know, the Allergy Food Awareness Network.
Oh, my God. Wait a minute, Brian. You've really touched RL. Hold on. Wait a minute. You want to know what? I've made so much money on these Goosebumps books. It's about time that RL gave back. So I will match your donation. Let me just get out my checkbook. Here we go.
That's very sweet.
Oh, shit. Oh. Fuck you. RL plays for Pete.
You motherfucker. RL Stine, I'm beginning to think you're not a great human being.
I'm beginning to think that you're the, like, what it... Hey, screw you, buddy.
He loses his eloquence a little bit sometimes.
Sorry, I've been in the hot tub quite a bit.
His brain's a little pruny right now.
I've got a lot of, Stein's got a lot on his mind.
Okay.
What's
next on the docket?
How about conspiracy koosh? Kush, kush. Kush.
Kush. Kush.
Kush. Kush. Kush.
Kush, you Visigoth.
A cross between Obama Kush and Space Queen, Conspiracy Kush's dense flowers produce a tangy citrus aroma and a peppery aftertaste. That's, I believe we're starting with RL.
Sorry, hold on. I just wanted to practice for when I light it.
All right, no, but meanwhile, have we have plenty. Audio listeners who are...
Oh, that was me chiefing on my think stick.
Sure. I love that little accessory that you have, your little holder.
I think it's called a toothpick.
Wrong. I'm RL Stine, I live alone, and I use a piece of pasta.
Oh, spaghetti!
Of course you do. Because why would you have toothpicks around for your poorly rolled
blunts?
Well,
the next thing you know, you get a little hungry, you toss it in the hot tub, boom, spaghetti.
Spaghetti is a very cost-effective.
A single noodle of spaghetti that worms its way around your chlorinated hot tub. I'm sure that's delightful.
What single noodle was the name of my unpublished 90s sex romp?
One single noodle.
One single.
All right,
it eventually turned into Kid Werewolf.
Not Teen Wolf?
No, the Goosebumps novel.
Got it, okay.
I'm sorry. RL, I believe you're up. Is this a real strain or a fake?
Conspiracy
what
Kush.
What was it?
Conspiracy Kush.
Fake!
I believe it's real.
RL Stine. I'm sorry to say, it's real. Smoke weed every day.
Just what I said, real.
No, I'm sorry. You seem a little bit high right now, RL Stine. Maybe.
Hey, reasonable minds can disagree.
Okay. Well, as you know, we're finally up to our billion point round, and
we are
tied at 3-3. This next round is worth 10,000 points, but we call it the billion point round.
Right. It's long.
Right.
Yeah. We're
all right. Well, all of this reminds me.
Can we time out for a second? Justin, can you just stare vacantly into the camera? Because
who?
Whoever.
RL Stine! RL Stine!
Treat it with some respect, Brian.
But when he does, he's got these perfect glows on his glasses that just make him look like he's seeing the face of God. It's straight up 2001 the whole time I'm talking to him.
Well, he's looking at that good loud. He's looking at that nice, nice.
All right. For 10,000.
RLC in double. The RL in my hand stands for really loud on that kush that I smoke in a blunt that I rolled myself poorly.
Yes. Okay. All right.
Perfect.
Final round.
All right. Our final round. Skunk driving. Notes of rye and oak create a strong euphoric high, perfect for a sociable night out. I think we're going to start with Brian. Skunk driving.
I will not explain
skunk
why.
Skunk driving. My favorite unpublished Goosebumps.
what was it about?
Unpublished.
It was about Ted Skunk, a young football player who was a long snapper but short in love.
I'm sorry, what's the job of the long snapper in football again?
The long snapper takes the ball and goes, I don't know, I'm RL Stine, I live alone, all right? You know.
Oh, so you wrote about the football star, but
so
not
Ted
really knowing
Skunk
about...
Ted Skunk is driving when all of a sudden he sees a mummy.
Oh. On the side of the road?
Just walking around.
And does he get cursed by this mummy?
No, the mummy stops him and he does the little like, I'm sorry, I'm holding my poorly rolled blunt. He's like, can you roll down your window? I'm a mummy.
Sure, they didn't have power windows back then. So
right. No, this is a period piece. It takes place in 1981 when Reagan fever is here, baby.
Catch it. Yeah, catch it. Got it.
Anyway, the mummy says, what's going on with this Reagan guy? And Ted Skunk says, well, if you teach me how to kiss a girl, then I'll tell you a little bit about our world. Next thing you know, they're off to the water park. Who wins the schooner race? Well, you'll have to buy it in Goosebumps Presents Skunk Driver.
Skunk driving, but okay.
Skunk driving. Hint, it involves driving.
Sure. A lot of your stories. All right. What do you think, RL? Or no, it's Brian.
Yeah,
Brian
no, it's
first.
To me. I think it's fake.
Okay.
Oh, skunk driving. I believe that is real.
You believe it's real?
Kate, before you reveal the answer, can I point out that I think there was a bit of a dog whistle in the description of skunk driving. And then it says it has hints of oak and rye, which are things that you say about whiskey, which I definitely just spent 2 days studying. And it would be amazingly coincidental if that happened to be in a real strain that happened to be the final thing of our thing.
That would be an amazing coincidence if I thought of that, but it is still a coincidence. It's fake.
Oh, wow. Wow.
I thought rye was in weed. or I thought rye was in beer.
Nailed it! Not again.
Weed. That's got to be the title. I thought rye was in weed.
Another win for RL Stine.
Well, not quite RL.
Notch it up. RL Stine's here.
I'm sorry.
I got to run.
RL Stine. I understand. I won, RL. You were a heck of a competitor.
Yeah, you tell a lot of tall tales. You remind me of a young, skinnier Shel Silverstein.
And that you hear RL Stine.
I just want to do a few quick plugs. Everybody, follow me on my Twitch channel, twitch.tv/rdizzle, if you want to see me play League of Legends and tell you all sorts of stories from the Goosebumps novel. Any Goosebumps fans in the house?
All right, get out of here. Just cut him off. Cut him off. All He's right. going to go here all night. So long, RL Stine.
As a kite by then.
Wow, what a good game.
Oh, man.
And he's gone. You want to do...
Hey, Bryce, hey. I think my new policy is just going to be to, you know, 10 minutes before the show starts, show up and say, like, I don't know, I want to talk about Alex Jones. and then have you say, like, I don't know, I got a game. And then have Justin say, like, oh, I got a way to make the game funny. And then we'll just do it.
Some people might call that producing a podcast.
Oh, that's fine. But 10 minutes beforehand and with 90% fewer goblins. Hey, man.
Do we normally have goblins?
I'll tell you what. Let's jump in. Let's go out of order. Let's do the movie draft minute.
All right. Yeah. Here's the movie draft minute.
Welcome to Movie Draft Minute, presented by CosmicRadio.tv for the week of April 17th, 2017. I'm your host, Roberto Villegas. This is my rifle. There are many like it, but this one is mine. My rifle is my best friend. It is my life. I must master it as I must master my life. Without me, my rifle is useless. Without my rifle, I am useless. Let's go check on the score. Team NatTech is in sixth place, still waiting for their first film. Team Portos is in fifth place, $28.5 million. Team Scotch Bros is in fourth place with $54.9 million. Team Frog Pants is in third place with $80.5 million. Team Big and Tall is in second place with $116.7 million. And in first place, the Fate of the Fear is bringing in $98.7 million. They bring their total to $123.7 million. It's Team DTNS. And that is your movie minute for the week of April 17th, 2017.
Hey, so about Roberto Villegas, do you think he's losing it?
What?
No. He's been doing movie quotes all this year.
Yeah, but this one seemed to start off like Full Metal Jacket and end like Full Metal Jacket.
Is Full Metal Jacket a movie?
Yeah. Who are you? An RL Stine? No. I think he's been doing the no commentary, all quotes. Because also it's like, I think for him it gets hard when it's just like every week it's like, there are some movies that came out, also other movies came out. Here we go. So he's putting a little art on it.
Yeah, I guess this one just went from the recognizable to the I'm concerned for you is all that changed.
Hear that? You're on blast, Roberto.
Yeah. You know what? Let's put a crazy watch out on Roberto, by which I mean we'll put an old
swatch on.
We'll
send him a watch.
Hey, so, dude, DTNS, did they – we just saw – like, okay, the only way we win is if DTNS – like, has major slip-ups time after time after time. So far, Smurfs The Lost Village shockingly shit the bed at $26 million. Followed by The Fate of the Furious that worldwide broke all the numbers, but domestically, how did it do, Justin?
Did about $65 million less on opening weekend than its predecessor, Seven, did, although that did have Paul Walker. So, and or what it was, the ending, the write off of Paul Walker. So, yeah, $107 million, still nothing to sneeze at, but it is not, now there is really a question on whether or not it's going to be a way over buy from DTNS for not a lot of bang.
So, think about it this way, DTNS spent 38 game dollars. Which we spent 58 on Guardians of the Galaxy. So let's be generous and call that 35 for them and 70 for us, which is insane. I think a 200 or close to a $200 million opening weekend run for Guardians of the Galaxy is not impossible, especially in light of the early reviews that you were hearing about.
Yeah, Screen for Critics yesterday. Critics are over the moon for it. They say it stacks up, if not is better and funnier than the original, that the new characters are great, that Baby Groot steals the movie. And this is to Brian's point, who has always said that this is going to be a gigantic movie because it's going to either end up on Earth or heavily, heavily, heavily set up the new Infinity War, that there are tons of surprises that people are saying, stop reading the internet. You're going to find out something you don't want to about that.
Ah, man, who saw this coming and has a name named Brian and just defeated RL Stine in a game of weed push things?
Man, he seemed a little unstable. I'm starting to worry about him. Let's put the crazy alert out on RL Stine.
Yeah. Yeah, man, I got to tell you, I thought we were totally screwed. I am more optimistic now than I was the night that we bought Guardians of the Galaxy. And I am more bearish on Team DTNS's stuff. In fact, I'll tell you what, we're going to do some Diamond Time. But in the meantime, why don't you guys in the chat throw together a straw poll and say whether you think it'll be Team Night Attack or Team DTNS. Because if there was ever a moment we are primed for an upset, now is it.
Well, again, really, what our chances hinge on not anything that we have, like you know, it's not Guardians of the Galaxy 2, and it's not Girls Trip. It's Pirates of the Caribbean. Pirates of the Caribbean has to overperform.
Well, but we only paid what, $35? Yeah, that was a bit pricey.
Yeah, that's you know, it would have been nice to turn that into two movies. Like two.
But I don't. Everybody was so shrewd. Like, we had a significant chance of just sitting on that $35, or buying one crappier movie overpriced.
Yeah. No, I mean, all things being equal, it's hard to win with a three-movie slate, but I like the way things are breaking so far.
Yeah.
Let's go ahead into Diamond Time. This is where you can shout out your projects right here on the show. Just head on over to reddit.com/r/diamondclub. Right up at the top, sticky to every single week, is that post for Diamond Time. And let's begin with Rivers Rubin. Hello, fellow Diamond Clubbers. A large company in Chicago is giving away $5,000 to five different local charities this month. The five are chosen by public votes online. A homeless shelter in my neighborhood would benefit massively from this donation. They work with the community, aiding those experiencing homelessness, to providing housing, meals, and a variety of social services. It's wonderful to see the good they do for people in our city, and this donation would go so far to help them continue to do so. My girlfriend works countless hours at the shelter, and it never ceases to amaze me how important it is to the lives of its guests. They're considering moving soon to accommodate more, and this would help them do it. You can only vote once a day until April 21st at the link below, and you can choose four other charities too. The shelter is listed as Lincoln Park Community Shelter. So head on over to tinyurl.com/Chicago Shelter and vote for Lincoln Park Community Shelter as much as you can.
I'll tell you what, man, contests like these, you know, let's face it, they're popularity contests, and this is how you get popular, is by hanging with the cool kids and getting the spotlight shined on them. You can make some real good happen to one of our own right there in their backyard. Meanwhile, new inductee to the Name Chant Corner Hour Hall of Fame, Poodle Puncher writes, "Greetings to the Diamond Group. Just a quick reminder that the next movie party is happening this Saturday at 9 p.m. CST on DiamondClub.tv. Please head on over to Twitter page at DC Movie Party and vote for what we will watch. Hope to see everyone there." Bryce, talk newbies into what you guys are up to.
Oh, I'm not a part of this.
Oh, what's movie party then?
They're going to watch a movie on
DiamondClub.tv.
On DiamondClub.tv.
Okay, are they going to watch it at the same time, or are they just going to each watch it and then report in at the end?
That's all a really great question.
I figured this was a Discord thing, because I know there's a Diamond Club
Discord.
Sure,
we do have the Discord at bit.ly/NADiscord. I don't know if this is going to be an IRC.
Man, it seems like this should have all been in the post. You know what?
Everybody's saying that everybody watches it together there on Saturday.
Yeah, it just seems like they should have, you know, Poodle Punch.
I mean,
really,
I appreciate the
down.
Short Reddit post.
Maybe
are we just going to shit on after we're like, Poodle Punch, thank you, man, so much, man. You're making our dreams come true. I mean, also, you could fucking fill that out a little bit.
I mean, you know. Okay, they use Rabbit. They use Rabbit.io, so you'll log into a group video, and then they have chat and voice.
Oh,
there.
Great. Right on. So if you want to hang out with and you get to group chat, that's the important part. If you want to hang out and watch a movie together with other Diamond Club members, head on over.
It's Saturday at 10 o'clock, 10 p.m. Eastern.
Heck yes.
Finally, Spiderbite writes, "Hello, Diamond Club. A few weeks ago, I posted a Teespring shirt to raise money for the MS Society under Mikey's name." Mikey Newman, of course, our quizmaster. "And good news, they met the minimum threshold. They should ship it in about a week. But now it's time to discuss another charity, the I'm Suddenly Between Jobs and Need Money Foundation. Add to this fund by buying a cool Diamond Club stuff at dctv.link/diamondswag. That is the link to the reasonably priced DC storefront on Teespring. Got shirts, mugs, and stickers that are kind of expensive, but I couldn't change the price on them. Go ahead and check it out. DCTV.link/diamond swag.
All right. On the upside, all of these, I'm sorry that the margins are not great on Teespring. We can't control that, but I'll tell you this much. The designs are svelte and simple and will resonate with Diamond Club fans. That is a fact.
What are some of these mugs here, bro?
Well, there's one that says Chips Bitch. What else is
what
there?
What do these other bugs say? I can't it's a little.
There's white people rich, bro.
Oh. Are white people rich? I haven't heard that.
Oh.
If only I heard somebody's name said two times in a row after that.
Yeah. Signify how rich they are. Yeah.
If only the show began.
Someone, you know.
All right.
Like, it would just be their last name as the echo, right?
Right. Yeah. It would be someone last name.
I mean,
last
whoever name. It was, they most certainly wouldn't have begun a podcast talking about how great it is to be able to afford to pay their tax bill.
Sure. Yeah. Or casually drop that they became a whiskey sommelier over the last 48 hours.
I knew he'd work it in.
God damn it. It's funny you mentioned that. Let me just put on this medallion here.
Oh, you didn't? They didn't give you a chain.
Well, I have to earn the chain. That's a second level institution.
Oh.
That's a level one doesn't get a chain. This just says I'm ready to learn.
Look at that. Oh, crap. Yeah, we can't throw to the movie draft minute. Brian, are we at the end of the show?
I think we are. We have to check in on our straw poll, though, about whether or not we're going to win or not.
Did that get made?
What's that?
I
don't know. I wished it.
Brian said it out loud.
That was like minutes ago.
Oh, okay. Here we go. Who wins DTNS, Night Attack, Other, or Pol Pot? The results are DTNS by 40%, Night Attack at 26.67, Pol Pot 26.67, and one vote for Other.
Other.
Yeah,
Other
well,
is...
you know, they still got Captain Underpants and Wonder Woman.
Okay, first of all, Bonnie left so I could say this out loud. Wonder Woman.
I heard some hot goss.
I heard a bit of hot inside goss that hot there's goss. Some not happiness happening in the not happy land. I heard
did
Diana.
You, did you hear that from the same person I heard it from at 3 a.m. his local time?
You know, or 8 a.m. our local time.
Do the math, gum shoes.
Yeah.
Who, by the way, started off the conversation by saying, I really don't want to get a reputation for this.
Didn't we have 40 minutes on responsibility on the internet?
I mean, listen, I let him know that much like his sovereign, he never calls too early. He never calls too late. He calls precisely when he means to.
Whoever that person is, I bet he's great. Okay, so I'm going to go ahead and lock in two underperforming movies for DTNS. So the only one is Captain Underpants. If Captain Underpants does not knock it out of the park, we've got a solid shot at this.
Well, I mean, like, who else has the big, like, who's got Spider-Man? So Big and Tall has Boss Baby, which overperformed. Rough Night, meh. Spider-Man could overperform. War of the Planet of the Apes could do well. I think Big and Tall's not out of this if DTNS underperforms. And then...
Wow, Big and Tall being like an actual contender would be huge. That's pretty crazy.
Here's the thing. If this is a weird fluke summer where there are no mega hits...
Hey, by the way, real quick, we're gonna wrap things up right now. We want to thank our primary sponsor, Reagan Fever 81, hashtag catch it.
Catch it.
Let's all get on the 405, roll a portly smoked blunt and hop in a hot tub full of ports. Let's hear it for I want to thank RL Stine for joining us.
Hey,
I want
to thank you to RL Stine. You know, he didn't really have to make it out there, but I was feeling uncomfortable. So thank you to RL who showed up.
Hey man, I want to thank my neighbor Alex Jones for keeping it real, except for when he's playing a fake character.
Yep.
I hope it doesn't undercut your credibility, brother.
First it was Alex Jones, and then it was Bill O'Reilly. El Rushbo, sneaking like a ninja, slicing everyone's throat around me. I will own the vertical yet again on the EIB network.
Real quick, can you give me your Twitch channel?
Oh, twitch.tv/lrushbow420. It's where I pwn noobs playing COD.
99.5 WRNO.
Dying of fire.
See you next Tuesday, patrons.
Night attack. 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 I love you.
Diamond Club hopes you have enjoyed this program.